Welcome, Sudhanshu Mittal.
Thank you, Vikram. Thank you for this opportunity.
You've been involved in politics since college, but you actually are from a business family. Your family has been very successful in business, and you decided to enter politics at an early age. And more recently, you've been involved with writing a book, RSS, Building India Through Sewa, or Service. I want to talk to you about both these things, a career in politics, and how is it in today's scenario, and of course, your book, which goes into great detail about the RSS, its history, and what exactly you feel needs to be brought out and told to the public. But the reason you write this book is quite interesting. You say that even though there are 9 million people who have enrolled, or approximately that number is what you've put down, there is very little information on the functioning of the RSS. Now, isn't that a bit of a contradiction of sorts? If 9 million people have joined the RSS, why is it that there is a lack of information?
9 million is not even 1% of the total population. So decimation of information certainly is an issue where the organization itself has had a very reluctant past. You know, it all comes from the Hindu ethos, which is seva ke bare mein bola nahi jata. Ye ishwariya karya hai. So it's serving God. When you do seva, it's a debt you have from the society, which you are actually repaying it. And you do not talk about it. That's the Hindu ethos. You know, you have donations. When we give donations, when we give chadhavas, we never talk about it. So noble works are not propagated as accomplishments. These are looked at as duties. So once you've done
but
your
one
duty...
One of the things you also do in the book is that you blame the media for a lot of information that you say has not been precise or correct. And you also blame them, saying that they have a very Western mindset.
I basically believe that the demonizing of RSS has an ideological motive behind it.
And what is
especially,
that?
Especially when I talk about the media, for over a lot of period, you've been observing that there is this mindset which is anti-Sangh, anti the Hindu identity of this country, entire the cultural ethos of this country.
But you painted the entire media with that
brush. Yeah, I do that because largely that's been the truth. See, when you look at anything, you say, what is the norm and what is the exception? So I'm not talking about the exceptions, I'm talking about the norm. And the norm is to demonize Sangh. You know, the moment you talk about Sangh, you'll start with 1923, you'll talk about 1947. I always say, evaluate an organization as to what it stands for today. Not in terms of the context of history, where the circumstances and the context are very different than what they are today. So if a Congress has to be evaluated, Congress cannot be evaluated that in 1885, Annie Besant started this with this objective, or they were the leaders of the freedom struggle. Yes, they were. But what has they degenerated into? So you have to evaluate Congress as what it stands for today. Similarly, either the Sangh or the work which is done must be evaluated in terms of its reality. And the reality is very surprising. It should be an eye-opener to people. The reality is this is the noblest of the noble organizations. I mean, an organization which has no parallel in the history of mankind. It is the largest NGO world over. In every field it has entered. Say, take the case of education. I mean, you're all very educated people. Can you think of any organization which has, say, even 1,000 points of presence? Mere 1,000 points of presence? No, you'll have none. And
but
look at the extent.
You say that the RSS is also changing and evolving.
Yeah.
One of the things that we've seen more recently is that perhaps the RSS is being more involved with the BJP at the ground level during election times, at least. Is that something?
I would always look at RSS from what it does. 24/7, 365 days.
But do you think it's more involved now in the political process?
No. I mean, it has always been the guiding force for BJP. Earlier in the avatar of Jan Sangh also, that was the umbilical cord which we had with Sangh, and we continue to be proud of it because it's a moral force which tells you, please follow the right path. So, I mean, the relationship of BJP and RSS is a very sacrosanct, very noble relationship where you look up to the institution for moral guidance, and that's about it. It's not the administrative bosses of the BJP which everybody would like to make out.
One question I have, which I didn't really get the answer to in the book, every organization has conflict within it. It's very normal in human nature. You put a number of people in a room, groups will form, conflict will take place. How does the RSS resolve conflict when you have obviously people who want to take leadership roles, people who want to do more, or who have difference of opinion on many subjects?
Largely, you must understand that why somebody joins the RSS, unlike why somebody joins the BJP. BJP has rewards to offer. So, organizationally, when you become a Mandal Pradhan or a Jila Pradhan, you know, when you head a district or a state, you wield authority. In Sangh, you wield only responsibility. Because there's no authority. It's a voluntary organization which basically is into Sewa. So, anybody who comes to Sangh comes to give something to the society rather than extract something in terms of rewards. Thus, the entire, the concept of contradictions and differences is very minuscule. For the simple reason that the objective is different. The objective is Sewa. I mean, I'm dedicating myself. Look at a Pracharak. I mean, people of such accomplished backgrounds leave everything, come live in a small room with probably a suitcase as their only asset, with five or four sets of clothing, and can move out in 2 hours' time to go to another place. Look at somebody from Maharashtra sitting in a remote village in Arunachal doing what? Running a Ekal Vidyalay.
But that still doesn't answer my question.
So as I said, because the objective of people who join Sangh...
More so. If the objective of one person is different from the other, maybe they both have very noble ideas, but they could be on a path of conflict. How do you resolve conflict?
As I said, because it is run on moral authority. So, depending on the level at which this individual is, he does look up to the leadership because of its moral stature. And these are the people who then sit down and they address his issues.
So, you have a structured hierarchy.
So it's a structural hierarchy which looks at addressing the questions which anybody may have in mind. And that's an integral part of the functioning, that you do address the concern or the confusions or the perspectives which may be different than what is the perspective.
And that brings me to another interesting part in your book where you talk about social media, and you say that it has been a sort of game changer for the RSS, because earlier you were dependent on just the traditional media, and now you're very happy that the social media...
It's got a voice now. I mean...
Yes.
You see, earlier only when BJP came to power was Sangh even taken cognizance of. And that too basically for BJP bashing. So if you had to do BJP bashing, the best way was to say Sangh is communal, Sangh is this, Sangh is that. So the entire narrative would build around Sangh. The moment BJP would be out of power, nobody will even talk about it. Now, Sangh did not have a voice of its own because of the obvious limitations in its impact in the media.
Why so?
Because of the ownership, because of the leadership of the media.
You mean
which had an ideological bias against them.
So, they were not given space?
They were neither given space, nor they were painted in the perspective they should have been painted. As I said, nobody wanted to evaluate the work of Sangh. Nobody wanted to say, okay, you have a 1 lakh Ekal Vidyalayas. I mean, 1 lakh villages have a school. As I said, jahan bijli nahi pahunchi, wahan Ekal Vidyalay pahunch gaya. I mean, can you imagine the kind of dedication, the kind of nobility, the kind of commitment to mankind which gets reflected in this. Look at the Kisan Sangh. How many farmers, their lives have been impacted. Look at in the field of medicine and medical facilities, the kind of dispensaries, the kind of hospitals, the kind of institutions Sangh has been running. It's phenomenal, and in terms of sheer magnitude, I'll give you one simple example. You know, there are a lot of institutions which have done good work, like Bill Gates Foundation or charity of missionaries and all. These scales have been minuscule. The leprosy ashram at Calcutta, it's small, 500, 600 people. Right from the 40s, Sangh has been running a leprosy center of more than 5,000 people. But these are not stories which Sangh has been talking about, because that's a commitment to mankind. It's a commitment to people. And these are innumerable such stories.
But how is a Sangh now going to use social media, or how is it using it?
A lot of ideological confusions which paint Sangh as anti, say, minorities, anti this, anti that. Sangh has been able to counter it and come out in the open and said, no, we are not. I mean, the other day, Mohan Bhagwatji, who had Sangh in Vigyan Bhavan, he held a open session. He says, for us to imagine an India without the Muslims, it's not possible. That's a reality, and they are our brothers. Now, this is so contradictory to the perception which has been created that you see a Muslim and you hate them. That is Sangh, which is, it is not. I mean, Hindu, the entire concept of Hindu is more cultural. It's not in terms of how you, jisko hum kehte puja ki paddhati pe basis nahi hai. So you have a Keshdhari Hindu, you have a Islamic Hindu, you have a Arya Samaji, you have a Sanatan Dharmi, you have a Shivaite, you have a Vaishnavite. So it is all encompassing. So the definition or the concept is that of a cultural ethos, where somebody looks at this country as its own, it's committed to the motherland and its cultural ethos. Now, this is interpreted in the narrowest of concept of what Sangh is parochial, Sangh is communal, Sangh is Rudivadi. I mean, this is an organization which has been the fastest changing organization. Its leadership changes so rapidly. It is an evolving organization. It has evolved itself in its philosophy or the way it looks at things. As I said, in 1923, the context was different.
How long did it take you to write this book, if I may ask?
It's a book which has been a thought process of the last 40 years. It's just got articulated now.
It's well researched. You've put down the history, I think, checking and double checking lots of facts. So it must have taken you a considerable amount of time. See, why did it take so long to write it?
There is again a context to that. As I said, every 5 years, every time when BJP comes to power, the favorite of every television media or anything is Sangh bashing. So I said, in all this, there is an opportunity for Sangh to bring out the real perspective. So the unknown face of Sangh, or the other face, the other side of Sangh, or the real side of Sangh. I said, this is just the right time, because there is a focus. Let really people know what Sangh is. Because once there is so much of media space given to them, since you are all from journalism, look at the cost of the media they get. I mean, probably it's worth billions and billions of dollars. I said, if you're getting billions and billions of dollars of publicity, might as well convert it to your advantage. So once you talk about Sewa and the magnitude of Sewa work which is done, it can't be debated. You cannot be accused of all what has been said about you. For the simple, there's no counter to it. How would you deny Sewa? How would you deny nobility? How would you deny that this is an organization which has a set of people who are so noble and so committed to the welfare of people? You can't deny that. So I said, let's convert. And that was the reason why I chose to bring this out.
You also chose politics. And that is something that many would say is a very difficult career option. You chose it early on. You didn't have to. You had a family business. In today's context, how do you see politics as a career option for people?
Frankly, 40 years back, we all believed that anybody who's not an idealist is a fool. Then we realized that after 25, who's one is a bigger fool. So I am of a generation which was, this is the immediate aftermath of the emergency era, and how seriously we took democracy, how seriously we took the future of India. And we all thought we'll be the builders of the future of India, ek naye desh ka nirman karna hai. So I think that ideological commitment was the driving force. We never looked at it as politics, because politics, an integral part of politics is power. So for somebody who is being an activist in BJP or the opposition, the thought that there could be power with BJP or, we could be ruling, was such an alien thought that it never crossed our minds. We were there to challenge the establishment. We thought it was a corrupt establishment. And we thought it is the responsibility of the youngsters to challenge this corrupt order and create a new order. And that's been that was the guiding principle. So I always make a distinction.
But in today's context,
we were activists. Mm. We were not politicians. Mm. We were activists.
But you call yourself a politician today, don't you?
I would still say in politics there are two kinds. So there are these activists who are romantic about changing India, and there are these careerists who think it's a career. As I say, I have a fundamental disagreement. Politics is not a career.
Whatever you do as a first choice becomes your career. Okay, so even if it's your hobby to start with, it would be your career later. My question is different. My question is, why the hesitation today to say, yes, you're a politician? Is it because politicians have too much baggage to carry?
No, I have no hesitation in saying I've been a political activist for the last 40 years and proud of it. I still nurse those ideas of contributing to the system. And that's my priority.
So
that's my passion.
So
for me, politics critically is an instrument of expression to a passion you have about doing something. That is why I say it's not a career, it's an expression of a passion.
So in today's context, if somebody's looking at politics as his mainstay, something that he's going to do for whatever purpose, for changing the way the country is, for bringing in good in a certain sector, or whatever else he'd like to do, do you think it's a good option today? Or do you think it has become so difficult and so, if I may use the word, unclean as a source of income? I'm, putting it very straight to you, that there's so much of baggage that goes with it. Why is it that that has happened? And do you think it is a right option for people to take today?
Vikram, the entire thing is, what is the purpose? If the purpose is the electoral politics, then the chances of success are minuscule.
You mean for a person who's honest and straight?
No. Any, be it the dishonest or the honest.
Okay.
The issue is, BJP has a membership strength of 10 crores, right? How many of them can become MLAs or MPs? I mean, it's most minuscule. So in the context of a success, if you look at the failures with this aspiration, the number is very, very large. So as a career option for this, I would never advise you, if that is the objective. Yeah, if the objective is that you feel passionate about it, I mean, whether you are an MP or you're not an MP or an MLA, you'll always have an avenue where you can express yourself or you can really contribute to the society. So the objective becomes very critical. Secondly, you said, given the current status of politics, where you look down upon politics as people who are crooks or probably the unclean people or the unclean funding and all that. Look, no system ever exists in vacuum. If the good don't come forward, the bad are bound to take their place. So never complain about it.
So therefore,
if you are willing to be a crusader in this system, and thus you are willing to fill up that vacuum with goodness, I mean, I think we would welcome everybody with the applause.
So the good must come forward, and they must try,
so
but they must never, come never with passion.
Never blame that, it's a bad set of people. So if the good don't come, then naturally the bad will come. One more thing. You see, politics is also a microcosm of the society. you cannot alienate your social character with that of people who will be a part of this. Unfortunate part of the story is that the degeneration of character of people has been phenomenal. And as somebody who's been very conscious about this degeneration, it pains you. It pains you because at the end of the day, what was critical to uphold the morality of people was also the fear of law of land. I still remember as a child, socially, when marriage proposals came for my aunt. So there is this marriage proposal from an engineer, and it was rejected for the grounds that iski to upar ki kamai hai. Because again, the romantic notion that kanun ke haath bade lambe hote hai aur kabhi na kabhi ye jail jayega. अगले 20 साल में क्या हुआ? अगले 20 साल में वो जेल नहीं गया, वो महल में चला गया. और जो ईमानदार था वो कहीं धक्के खाता रहा. तो पीपल डिस्कार्डेड दिस. फिर बाद में जब एक कज़न के लिए रिश्ता आने लगा तो देखने के ये इसकी ऊपर की कितनी कमाई है. सो लुक, दिस चेंज वॉज लार्जली बिकॉज एज अ फंक्शनिंग डेमोक्रेसी द प्राइमेसी ऑफ द मजिस्ट्री ऑफ लॉ हैज़ फेल्ड अस. There could be multiple reasons. I personally hold judicially accountable to this. Dispensation of justice was the most critical thing when it comes to the majesty of law. But the failure to dispense with justice not only defeated justice, the impact it had on the social minds, on the fear of the majesty of law, it just dissipated it. People thought kuch nahi hone wala. मैं कुछ भी कर लूं, आई कैन गेट अवे विद इट. सो दिस ट्रांजिशन ऑफ आर सोशल वैल्यूज, आर मॉरल सिस्टम्स हैव गॉट डीजनरेटेड इनटू पॉलिटिक्स एज वेल. सो आई वुड नॉट बिलीव, बट लेट मी अगेन डिस्पेंस विद अ नोशन. इफ आई लुक एट ब्यूरोक्रेसी, इफ आई लुक एट पॉलिटी, एंड इफ आई लुक एट एनी अदर क्लास ऑफ पीपल इन्वॉल्व इन सर्विस, I would still find a politician more sensitive to human beings than any other class. You go at 2 o'clock to his door, knock it, he will come out and he'll try to help you. There would be bad apples, but largely at a people's level, the relief comes from a politician. Try going to a bureaucrat's house at 10 o'clock, what to talk about 2 o'clock. The contempt with which you'll be met with. So, politics has a lot of commitment to people, politicians, genuinely. I mean, I would talk about a
score. People's person. Unless you're a people's person, you can't get into politics.
You have to be a people's person.
Tell me about yourself now. What do you plan in the future? After this book, what next?
I mean, as I said, for me, it's passion. I've always had a thought process about what is to be done. I just push my agendas. I have not been
What's
a
your
man,
latest agenda?
As I said, there are a few reforms which I personally feel can be accomplished. I mean, I am one who believes that you have to build in administrative capabilities in the political system. You know, we are all trained in the arts of agitating and, fighting the establishment. But we have no training in how to run the establishment. So the moment we come to power, our critical problem is we have to depend on the same bureaucracy we've been fighting all through. Because we do not know the systems, how they have to be governed. So I've been propagating this idea of establishing an institute of democratic studies or something of that kind, where the system must send its people, say a 100-seat institution, with, depending on your pro rata strength in the parliament, you nominate people to undergo a course which is similar to what a probationer undergoes, 1 year course or 1.5 years course. And in that period, you are trained and you are enlightened with the entire apparatus of governance of this country. What will happen is in a period of say 15 years, you'll build up a very strong pool of talent in the political system, which will contribute tremendously in political governance. And that would be a game changer. See, you so often hear that neta kuch nahi karta, jeetne ke baad wo kabhi jata nahi, you know, all these things, the contempt. I'm yet to come across a public man. I'm not talking about the Rajya Sabha varieties. I'm talking about people who've got elected. Again, forget the aberrations. In the norm, everybody wants to make his constituency heaven. For the simple reason, it will yield results. If you are able to do development of that constituency, naturally you will have better claims to vote. So everybody wants it. Why doesn't that happen? Because we don't realize that we have not given statutory authority to these members of parliament. They have no authority. They have all accountability, all responsibility, no authority. I mean, it's a very strange system of governance we have developed in this country. I think the British legacy has done greater damage, that the parliamentary form of democracy has created a system which will only generate hate because of the limitation of the elected representative.
So what is the other that you have in mind?
I still believe that we must really look at the presidential form. Large democracies with huge numbers, I would think, would be better served with a presidential form of government. And along with that, the authority which should be wielded by a member parliament who's so elected should be a statutory authority in terms of his development, in terms of his rights, in terms of how he will affect governance in his own constituency. He must have a role.
Well, that's a subject for another debate.
Yeah.
And we wish you luck with your agenda. Thank you for sharing your views with us.
Thank you so much.